Wheels Along the Road on BCTV is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road here on BCTV, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm your host, Kendra Cook. Well, Happy New Year to everyone there at home. Welcome to 2017. And hopefully we're going to kick the year off right here tonight. Well, the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles is located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. And we are open 7 days a week. And we have plenty of vehicles on display, horse-drawn pieces, carriages, and wagons, sleighs. But we also have plenty of cars and trucks, even a couple of motorcycles there. We'd love to see you at the museum. And if you would like to contact us there, you can give us a call, 610-367-2090, or visit our website, www.boyertownmuseum.org. Or if you'd like to send us an email, you can use mail, M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org. You can also check out the museum's Facebook page. You've got plenty of updates, as well as some automotive history and oddities that we post on there, and encourage you to check out the Wheels Along the Road Facebook page for updates for the show. Like I said, the museum is open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m., and we're closed major holidays. And in January, again on Saturdays, we will be offering blacksmithing demonstrations in the Jeremiah Swinehart Carriage Factory. It's included with the normal admission. It's a perk to our Saturday visitors. So if you can get out there on a Saturday and check out the blacksmith, it's always interesting and entertaining. We'd love to see you then. Well, we're so glad that you decided to join us for Wheels Along the Road tonight here on BCTV. And as always, we broadcast live the first Tuesday of every month at 9 p.m. And we love to hear from our visitors at home. The number here at the studio is 610-378-0426. And we'll get
And how that. Well we know that phone number, too.
Yeah, we had a broken door. We'll
yeah,
say that.
They were trying to keep us out.
Yeah, well, can you blame them? We'll give that number to you again at the end of the program when we get to the car quiz. So with me tonight to kick off our 2017 season is our, of course, regular panelist, Dan Olson, and our semi-regular, Sam Fiorani. Thank you, gentlemen, both for coming in tonight. And to my understanding, you're going to kind of have one big discussion going on, so I'm just going to sit back and put my feet up and drink my coffee, and I'm going to listen to your presentation tonight.
Wow.
Yeah, great.
Yeah.
She expects a lot.
I do.
We'll give it a lot.
Raise the bar.
I see so many papers, and there's props. They're good. They're fine.
It's leftover from New Year's, you know, it was confetti and stuff.
Just reached in the paper shredder, huh, and took it out?
Little drinking, little writing.
Yeah. Good. All right, what do we have the history of tonight?
We're going to talk about regulations and how they've affected the design of cars. Okay. And I brought this little prop for you.
Oh.
It was the smallest model I could find in my collection.
Okay.
It's only 1/49th scale.
1/49th.
Okay. And when people talk about the history of cars, they usually talk about the early 20th century as being the Wild West, no regulations, and
right,
and how design could be whatever you want it to be. Well, this little car here could be any car from 1910 to 1930. It a vertical grille, a vertical windshield, optional roof, running boards, but nothing really regulating the car itself. Can you name that car?
Let me see the side of it again. Oh, I'm going to guess any car. I don't know. Am I allowed to look at the bottom? And
no, that's where the name is.
Oh, okay. No, I couldn't. I don't know.
This happens to be a 1933 Datsun.
Oh, okay.
But it could be virtually any car. It could be a Ford, it could be a Chevy, it could be the Austin, which on which the design's based. But we don't have any real regulations at that time to alter the looks of the car, but they all seem to look pretty much similar at the time.
Right.
And then today, when people say that everything looks similar, they do look distinctly different if you look at different cars. Mm-hmm. And that's despite all the regulations that have required the cars to look particular in a particular way. I looked back to find the earliest regulations I could find, and the first one that I could find specific to the automobile was safety glass.
Okay.
Windshields were optional on early cars. Model Ts were optional in 1908. Mm-hmm. And to get glass on the front of the car, it was glass. It was just a pane of glass. And laminated glass didn't start until 1919 with the Model T.
And it was interesting when they had glass windshields, because the side window, they didn't have side or back windows, but the windshield. And there was debates over that because it was unsafe. They figured if you were in an accident, you'd go flying through the windshield and so on and so forth. And
at the ungodly speed of 25 miles an hour.
Yeah. And so there was pros and cons about having glass, period. And so, if you had a Model T and you added a windshield, I'm sure there was a lot of people say, oh, well, you shouldn't have added that. And there was other people say, well, no, it's good because it keeps the bugs out of your teeth.
Right.
So,
yeah, the first laminated glass was invented in 1903 by accident.
Mm-hmm.
Scientists had a beaker with what was cellulose nitrate in it, mm-hmm. and it had solidified, but you couldn't see it. And they put it up on the shelf, and when it fell, it didn't break. And when it did break, it stayed together. So the glass all stayed in one form, and that's how they developed safety glass eventually.
Huh.
So the first safety glass laminated glass was in a Model T in 1919, and triplex, the stuff we use now, mm-hmm. was invented in the 20s. And the Model T was the first one to introduce that in 28.
I remember reading about that laminated glass and the triplex and stuff. It had a lot of background in the aircraft industry from back in that era. And I don't even think, you look at pictures of old airplanes and they didn't have any windshields or anything, but I guess what they did have, maybe just a little thing in front of the pilot.
Yeah, by the 20s, they were going fast enough that they would need a windshield.
Mm-hmm.
And safety glass, if you don't know, safety glass is two sheets of glass with plastic in between to hold it together so that when something impacts it, then the glass will stay together even though it shatters. Safety glass was finally mandated in cars in 1937. So that was the earliest actual mandate I could find. Did you find anything earlier than that?
For glass, no.
For anything in the automotive field that was
mandated. Now, when you say mandated, that's by the government, right?
Correct.
Okay. No, I didn't find that. I saw SAE standards, which is Society of Automotive Engineers. I saw they had standards going back way before that. But no, I didn't see any federal regulations.
Yeah, SAE would set standards for different parts of the car so that everybody was working together and make rules on how engines worked, how transmissions worked, mm-hmm. the definitions of general things, but they didn't, nothing was required until around World War II. Hmm. So you want to move on to headlights?
We could go on the headlights, yeah. And it's interesting, now you were talking and I saw the model you just stuck next to me here, and I'm not really looking at it directly, but I know they had smooth headlights that kind of went in along the contours of the body.
Well, yes, the earlier cars, you could put any kind of headlights you want on. The headlights could be any size, could be any shape. In 1939, Plymouth had square headlights,
mm-hmm.
but round headlights were standard on most cars, and luxury cars would go up to the larger size headlights as they were getting older. But by 1940, seal beam headlights had been invented and were required. And they were required in particular sizes. All the seal beam headlights in the US were the same size. So they were mandated to have two, only two.
And it was, I think, 7.5 inches?
Seven inches, I believe, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
And when was this?
1940.
Okay.
Now, before you do that, let me throw something. I told you about the SAE standards. I came up with headlight standards for 1916, okay? And again, the Society of Automotive Engineers in this country came up with these standards that they want to do. And I think probably most standards in automobiles have come through that. You know, they do all the study and then the government says, you know, let's make this, you know, we have to have it. And if you can show the first picture we have is some headlights. Thank you. You can't see that real well, but you have three headlights there pointing out. And you notice the one on the top, it shows the lamp or the bulb is at a correct position where the light beams are coming straight out from the reflector. And if you see the middle one, that bulb is too far away from the reflector and you see skewed beams. And then the bottom one, the bulb is too close to the reflector and you kind of see beams going out to the side too. And that was the regulation they were talking about, is they didn't have regulations with the little bulb that you would stick in your light, you know, the little 1-inch thing or 2-inch thing. And it could be, you know, you could put it into the socket and it might be a different distance away from that reflector. And that reflector would act as like a focusing beam. So if it's further away, as you can see in that diagram there, it would come up kind of fuzzy. And they had a regulation they were trying to do, and I'm going to read this. It says, a headlamp of an automobile will give adequate light combined with elimination of glare when, number one, the light is sufficient to reveal any person, vehicle, or substantial object on the road straight ahead at a distance of 150 feet. Two, there is sufficient side illumination to reveal any person, vehicle, or substantial object 10 feet ahead of and 10 feet to one side of the lamp. And three, the headlamp is so arranged that no portion of the reflected beam of light when measured 75 feet or more than 75 feet ahead of the lamp shall rise above 42 inches above the level surface on which the vehicle stands. So they're talking, you know, the amount of illumination going out, the height of it, so you don't get glare. You know, you're driving in a car now, you're probably driving, you got that little silver gold thing there, you okay? Your eye level's about this high, and a pickup truck's behind you, and their headlights are up here, and it glares. And so back then, they were talking about, you know, those types of height, and they've kept that all through, you know, 101 years now. And so that's the earliest standard I found with. So I kind of interrupted you there, but let's go back to like 1940 when the government regulated the sealed beam headlight.
Well, like I said, the sealed beam headlights were required for two headlights and of a specific size. And it wasn't until 57 that they were allowed to have four headlights, which were slightly smaller. I think they were 5.5 inch each.
Right.
And so by 57, you were allowed to have two headlights or four headlights. And nothing more dramatic than the seal beam headlights that you can buy at Pep Boys. You replace the whole bulb, not just today we can replace a bulb, but it was the whole unit that got replaced originally. A glass unit, all sealed. That was 57. In 74, the first quad rectangular headlights came out. In 77, the dual rectangular headlights. And it wasn't until 1983 that Americans were allowed to have flush headlights. So the flush headlights allowed the design to change. Whereas prior to 40, you could build anything you wanted in a car, placing the headlights anywhere. So the sealed beam headlights required two of those being mounted on the sides, the four headlights in 57, and then the rectangular headlights through the 70s allowed lower noses, smaller headlights, lower hood lines, better aerodynamics. And in the early 80s, Ford and Pontiac had negotiated with the government to allow flush headlights. And so we finally got the flush headlights, which allow the body to blend right into the headlights.
Mm-hmm. I saw a picture, we're talking about rectangular headlights, and I'm trying to think what car it was. It was an English car from the 80s, and it had this long, pointy nose, pretty pointy, but the front was cut off, mm-hmm. and you had to have rectangular headlights, or, I don't know, probably 4 inches right. high and pretty wide, and it was all, it kind of looked too angular there.
Yeah, the Aston Martin Lagonda.
Those
headlights were fogger driving lights. The actual headlights popped up off the hood.
Oh, okay.
They were actually hidden on the, okay. off the hood. But they were also flush. They mm-hmm. were mm-hmm. Europeans used flush headlights dating back into at least into the 60s.
So now we have the flush lights as in this red vehicle. And you know, there's a lot of styling that can they use that as part of the styling.
Absolutely. No, in before this, in order to get a flush front end, you'd have to hide the headlights. Concealed mm-hmm. headlights were very popular in the 50s, 60s, 70s. And once they could get away from the seal beam headlights and move towards replaceable bulb and a flush headlight, now they can design the whole front end and add in windshield headlight wipers and yeah. all kinds of nice little features.
Yeah, and you talk about the headlights, the hidden headlights to keep a certain look to the car. Mm-hmm. And I think, okay, the 63 Corvette, okay, the hidden headlights there. Imagine exposed headlights on that. And I can't. That wouldn't work.
But today you could replace that nose.
Correct.
Exposed headlights in that shape.
Yep.
In the 60s, some cars came with plastic headlight covers.
Mm-hmm.
And by the late 60s, those had been outlawed. So the Chryslers and other vehicles that had covers over the seal beam headlights, they were replaced by the late 60s because they were outlawed. In the late 70s, Dodge came out with a couple models where they had plastic covers over the headlights, but that was retractable. So when you turn the headlights on, the plastic cover moved away, even though you could see the headlights through them.
Hmm. And when was that outlawed again with the plastic?
It was 65 or 66, I think.
Okay.
The early 60s, Imperials had them.
Yep.
And by about 66, they had them.
I've also seen a mid-60s Ford. They had the stacked headlights. And I don't know if that was an option. You could get a clear covering on it.
It must have been an
option. I've seen a magazine. Right. I saw one at a show. But it was pretty
going back
unique.
To Corvettes, the 53 Corvette originally had a cover over the headlights.
Okay.
But had been outlawed by the late 60s. So the other lights I had were the turn signals.
Okay. One last thing about headlights here. Intelligent headlamps. Okay? You didn't
intelligent?
Know.
Intelligent?
Yeah, you didn't. You haven't met a dumb one yet.
Not yet.
Okay.
Give me time.
And it's interesting, and most of this technology is in Europe. But they have LED lights, and they have all the little LED items in the light. And like when you're making, let's say, a right turn, the mm-hmm. LED lights on the right side of the, we'll say, a headlight turn on, mm-hmm. and they're illuminating that. And it also reads, you know, the if traffic's coming towards you, you have your high beams on, it'll go automatically to low beams, which has been around for years. But it was that kind of interesting one, because if you look at the Tucker, I believe the Citroen in France had it, they had lights that turned with the wheels, but the light was a mechanical,
right.
You know, they were moving. Well, now with the LEDs, they're turning these little, I believe they call them pixels, mm-hmm. and turn them on, and that's the latest thing. And
headlights can turn legally in the U.S.
They can.
Lexus introduced them about mm-hmm. 10 or 15 years ago,
okay.
where the headlight itself can mm-hmm. turn in a corner as long as it still has straight headlights.
Okay.
But the headlights you're talking about are illegal in the U.S. at the moment.
At the moment.
And I am waiting for them to come in because they're brilliant. The ones you're talking about, Audi has some that they're demonstrating mm-hmm. where I don't know if they have 40 pieces to the headlights. Yeah. Each headlight has 40 different units. And if the light is on, and I'm trying to demonstrate what you had drawn there. If the light is on and some, because it's always running on high beam, but if somebody is coming towards you, it will turn off certain lights so that that other car is in the dim spot of the headlights as it passes, and they'll alternate through, so you always see the road ahead of you. Wow. But you won't see, the high beams won't be on the traffic coming at you.
Yeah. It's kind of, you think, is it necessary? I think it is, because people are going faster, you need the better headlights, and these LED lights are better as far as projecting further
and clearer.
Yeah. They have that whiter light. And
how many times have you driven down the road and someone's high beams are coming right at you?
A lot.
Yeah.
So
I was coming up 422 tonight, and people didn't have their lights on at all. So
yeah. Yep, that too.
So, but it's just kind of interesting. You know, we think we've seen everything, and they're constantly pushing the envelope or expanding that envelope.
But making the headlights like that, where you have 40 pieces and 40 reflectors and 40 LEDs, mm-hmm. allows you to design the front end differently, yeah. and work around that, so you can put the lights all over the place and still.
And you do see some cars, higher end cars, I think Audi's one of them, and the lights are kind of this decoration almost. It's distinctive. So although the cars are kind of look all the same, that's an Audi because of the way the headlights are.
When we were kids, when a car came down the road, you could tell from its headlights or taillights, just the way the headlights were sitting in the car, mm-hmm. what kind of car that was. And then there was a period of time where they all looked alike.
Right.
And now with the LEDs that they have in these cars, they kind of have a signature. They have a light signature to the front of the car, and they design that in so that you can see that the Audis have a particular ring around the headlights.
Mm-hmm.
GMC trucks have C's in the headlights. The different brands have their own signature, mm-hmm. so that everybody can tell that car coming down the road, yeah. just from the LED signature. It doesn't light up the road any. Those particular LEDs do not light up the road anymore.
Okay.
They're more
like a parking light,
running light. Yes,
running light.
But they cost a lot to make, but they set off the face of the front of the car.
Yeah, somebody told me about headlights. You know, people would be buying these high-end cars, used ones, because they can afford, you know, or whatever, and then the headlight goes bad, and the headlight costs a lot of money.
I'm going to say, to fix one of those.
Yeah, because it's not, you know, where we started out with the seal beam.
Yeah, going into the store and buying a bulb for $6 or $8.
Yeah, and you buy it and take it out, you put another. Yeah. Well, now it's you know, old, like, I guess my headlight on my car has a bulb, but it's a whole housing and it's
yeah.
mm-hmm. special shape.
If the bulb goes, it's only $10. If the housing goes, it's $200.
And it only fits my car.
In your particular year, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's the great thing about the design, is that you can change it for each car, but then you can change it for each car, so you're building fewer mm-hmm. of them. Whereas these are built in millions of, tens or hundreds of millions of units. Yeah. These are built in thousands of units.
Yeah. But now you're saying, now these intelligent lights that you were mentioning, they're not allowed here in the States yet. Is that because, why is that? Do we have to deem them safe first? Is it just one of those things where they're really expensive?
It's a conspiracy.
Is it a conspiracy, Sam?
They work to make sure that everything's safe. And the American government typically does that with regulations on lighting and making the whole car safe, analyzing all the parts and making sure that everything is as inexpensive to use as possible and as reliable as possible and as safe as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, that's why we had sealed beam for so long. Mm-hmm. Somebody had to convince them that
this was better.
The European style headlights would work long term, and we had issues with them because everybody had a car in the 90s that yellowed.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep. So cloudy. The cloudy plastic. Yep.
Yeah. After a time, that plastic would yellow. Well, the newer plastics are better. So mm-hmm. it's a learning curve on all levels.
Right.
But those headlights are so mechanical that you have to make sure you have constant light and make sure that it works the way it's supposed to work. We're going to talk about autonomous vehicles, but you're going to have fail-safe modes so that mm-hmm. the car will stop and not crash if something goes wrong.
Right.
Same thing with the headlights. You're not going to have that control anymore. We have a vehicle at home that has automatic high beams, and it drives me insane because it's not turning on as much as I want it to.
Yeah.
There's no one on the road, but it senses some light ahead of me. And imagine if the whole light works that way.
Yeah.
And if a couple of those bulbs go out and suddenly you have a blind spot on your right side or your left side or one spot, it'll be annoying.
Yeah.
But they are going to come on high-end cars, so it's going to be, the first cars are going to be $100,000 cars that have these lights.
Mm-hmm. So, that's headlights.
Headlights.
What do we have next on the list there?
Well, I have that turn signals showed up in 1907, but flashing turn signals weren't invented until 38.
In what car?
Wow.
I don't have the car on that one.
Buick.
38 was the Buick?
Yeah.
Okay.
38 was a Buick, and if you give me a moment, I'll tell you what they were called. Flashway directional signal.
Oh.
Flashway.
Ooh.
Okay. Now, you said 1907 they came out. I came across a couple of things for turn signals that you could buy. This is 1917, and let me find them here. And here's one. It's called the Green Hand Signal. Sounds like a secret society doesn't it?
Now we're getting into conspiracy theories Illuminati. Great.
And basically, it's a lit thing, and it shows a picture of one here in the front of a car. And the picture's not that great. That's why you don't see it on your screen. But you can see it, like, between the headlights, there's a box about this big, and there's a hand pointing either one way or the other way, and it would be green.
Mm-hmm.
And why green? I think it even says here, if you give me a moment here, color green is used for the hand because it denotes safety and is considered to be the most adaptable color for both day and night signaling. So that was a green hand safety signal in 1917.
Wow.
Also, there's another one here, and it's called the Handy Signal, and it's HAND-Y-Signal. And basically, it's this box, and I saw one of these online. Somebody had one on a Model A that he found, and he had it mounted like right there on a door or the edge of the window right next to him. And there's a lever. You pull a lever down, and it's like a scissor type thing with the hand goes out, and points out, and it means you're going
to... Does it have a boxing glove on the hand, too? No,
it's just the hand.
It's like a gloved hand.
And it just goes out, and... You know, they used to teach when I learned how to drive
way back
the hand signals, which whatever they are, and you know, there's that.
You
stuff.
Really learned that, didn't you?
Oh yeah, right. My car had turn signals built into it. I didn't have to remember, but I don't know what this did because all it did was just go straight out. I guess maybe it was for stopping. I really don't know. It was just a signal, I guess.
Well, around that time, they started with semaphores in Europe.
Yes.
Where a bar would come out from behind the driver's side door, and it usually had a reflector or a light in it, and it would just tell you you're turning that direction, and there was one on each side. Mm-hmm. And those were used from the 20s to the 60s.
You know, when I was reading about this stuff the last few days, I was thinking, if you're behind a car, and, okay... Let's see. You're in, we'll say Germany. So you're driving from the left side of the car, and you're behind another car. And if they turn the right signal on,
you may not see it.
Yeah, you can't see it. You know.
Yeah, because they were in the middle of the body. Yeah. So when it came out, so it had to be long enough to come around the corner of the body. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
Yeah, absolutely. But you mentioned the green lights. That amber lights weren't required in the U.S. until the early 60s.
Right. Right, I think I had something like that in here somewhere among all my paperwork. So,
but American laws required signals on the corner markers starting in the 68 was the first year.
January 1st,
68 had to have either a reflector or a light on the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And then January 1st of 70, it had to have a reflector and a light.
Okay.
So the corner markers were an American thing, and you can see the European ones too. European ones have them midway back the body, and you'll see that occasionally on a European car that makes it to the States, they'll have one.
And it's interesting, we're talking about the design that they use with the newer type of headlights, how you can use that in the design, and I've seen them also do that now with the side indicators. I think Corvette has them right there in a wheel opening.
Right.
And maybe
right.
somebody else has them too.
Yeah.
And I've seen some other
usually
ones.
Usually they just look tacked on. You know, they usually just look added on, but some designers get away with really good positioning of it. That's what I got. I got one more light thing.
One more light.
The third brake light, and this one has one. The third brake light back here, we call the center high-mounted stoplight, or the chimsel.
The chimsel.
Yes. The chimsel was mandated in the U.S. starting in 86 on cars and 96 on trucks.
Okay.
And Canada followed right with the U.S., and Europe followed a number of years later.
Another light, you talk about that chimsel light, okay, and I never even heard of this until I started researching this, is the rear fog lamps in Europe.
Europe, yeah.
And are they just while you're driving so people can see you in foggy?
When you turn on your front headlights, there's rear lights that are brighter than the driving lights, but dimmer than the brake lights.
Okay.
But not enough dimmer that you wouldn't notice it. So if you're driving behind somebody who has their fog lights on, driving a European car, you think they're riding the brake.
Okay.
And I still want to pull the people over and say, turn off your fog lights. It's not foggy outside.
Are those lights, are they red also?
Yes.
Or are they? Okay. Yeah. I was thinking if they were some sort of amber thing.
No, it's usually within the same setup of the taillights. But they're brighter than your driving lights.
And I found, it's another thing I came across, and I'm kind of looking through my notes real quick to find where I wrote it down. But some of the light regulations, especially in Europe, were mandated by the United Nations. You know, the League of Nations, if it was prior to that. And when I first saw United Nations, I thought, well, that's just the term they use. But no, it's the United Nations, you know. And I'm thinking, wow, that was interesting. That kind of took me by surprise there. But it seemed like more of it was in Europe.
A lot of these regulations prevented cars from coming into the U.S. easier.
Yes.
So if you had to put these things on a car, then you had to re-engineer a car for this or that.
Mm-hmm.
Probably originally, it seemed like Japanese cars wouldn't come over because they were all right-hand drive. And the Japanese, all the way through from the late 50s on, always decided they were going to build American cars. And so there were very few regulations coming to the U.S. that were a big problem.
Mm-hmm.
But the one thing that I think has changed the design, the one regulation that has changed the design of cars the most are the bumpers.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
So prior to 1973, bumpers were usually trimmed right up along the body. They looked really nice. They fit into the design of the car very well.
Mm-hmm.
And like the lights, the original designer could make them. They were more ornamental than anything else, especially these smaller bumpers in the 60s and such. But by the early 70s, they needed to actually stop the car. And especially when you have a 5,000-pound car.
Mm-hmm.
Starting in 73... the regulation for bumpers was that the bumper had to withstand a 5-mile-an-hour crash without damaging the body. So, whereas prior to 73, the bumpers tacked right up alongside the body, they were part of the design of the car. Starting in 73 for the front and 74 for the back, the bumper stuck out, and everybody knows the ugly cars of the mid to late 70s where the bumper stuck out 3 and 4 and 5 inches on each side and 6 inches out front.
Well, before you went like this, and it almost looks like they're sticking out that much. You know,
oh, absolutely. They stuck out quite a bit. This model doesn't really show it so well, but this bumper is not as flush as it had been a few years earlier. And they had to have filler back in here to protect the body once the bumper compressed. But they've gotten really, really good with that, to the point where you can't even tell where the bumper ends and the body begins.
Yeah.
And modern cars have done a very good job of
well, doing that. Well, a lot of people say, well, they don't have bumpers. Well, they do. They're just covered up with like the plastic.
All the bodywork. All the plastic and the fiberglass and everything has has sealed up the bumper really nicely and made it flush again with the bodywork. So that now when a designer comes in, they can say, I want this look. Mm-hmm. And there's no additional bumper on the outside. All the engineering has to go underneath the body.
You have the Camaro out here, and I do remember there were some cars in that era that had the urethane-covered bumper.
By the late 60s, they had started doing that.
There was a few of them. The Camaros had them.
Pontiac.
That was Pontiac, and one of the Mopars, were they the Challengers, had them. And, that was part of the design, part of the look. And
it worked really well, except, as all these things go, that they would crack.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't age very well. Yep. But when you see one in a car show that's in good condition, somebody's taking care of that one, because they would tend to crack originally. But eventually they got to the plastic we have today, and it works really well on a car.
So all the way at the, we covered everything there. So do you have anything else? We could go on.
Oh, yes. No, from massive restraints that have required airbags. And if you look at a car that had airbags 20 years ago compared to a car that has airbags today, the airbag on my car is this big now.
Hmm.
Whereas 20 years ago, it was this big. And they've packed them very well. And you can now redesign the interior. Whereas before, you had to put that big
accommodate this
pillow.
Big thing.
Right.
Yeah.
It had to take up a lot of the interior space.
There are so many safety regulations, or we'll say so many regulations, most of them are concerning safety.
Mm-hmm.
And you really can't argue against them.
No.
Some people do. But you think, how many lives are saving? But I think as quick as they're saving lives, people are driving more recklessly, with the cell phones and just recklessly without them, and they're faster. The cars go a lot faster now.
Right.
So, and I think of one thing, safety regulations, and I came across something, and I don't have it with me, but it was about car seats for children and infants, okay, mom? You think about your kids there, and they probably don't like it. They want to sit up in the front seat next to mom.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's where the cool people
sit.
That's right.
But again, 20 years ago, we had to put in the car seats, and every car was different, and the latch mount, and now they're standardized. So everybody, they clip in fairly easily. You can put in a car seat properly in a matter of seconds, whereas 20 years ago, you had to figure out how this car worked, and you had to make sure the seatbelt locked and put everything. It was a pain, but dropping in a latch, with the system they call a latch, dropping in a latch seat now, it's two clips, tighten them up.
Well, now the cars come with the latches in them.
Right.
You don't have to strap
the seats go
the
right
seat belts in. Because the cars all come with these little hooks in the crack between the back and the seat.
Yeah,
so
they're usually really easy to find, and it's great.
When I was a kid, we didn't have kid seats.
No, you sat on just a tunnel in the back.
We just
facing back,
ran around in a ragged in the back seat.
Well, even that, they change all the time, because now I think the American Society of Pediatricians or something like that, they now are saying that children need to be rear facing until they're two.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is like a nightmare to me.
Especially you get a long-legged two-year-old who's just
cramped
in there.
Well, that was my son. I can't imagine trying to put my son in a car seat until he was two that faced the back, but they change it.
When I was a kid, our only safety requirement for kids in our family was stay out of arm's length.
That was personal safety. That wasn't personal safety.
Yeah.
And be quiet. No one will get hurt.
But I think the regulation that started our whole conversation on this was a year or two ago. We started talking about emissions regulations.
Mm-hmm.
And currently, car companies have to have fuel economy on their whole fleet. But the new laws don't require it by the whole fleet. They require it by the size of the vehicle. So each vehicle size has to meet a particular regulation. And the way the law is written, it's by footprint. It's by the width of the tires, by the length, by the wheelbase of the vehicle. So a larger footprint will get easier fuel economy in the future. which is going to directly affect the design of cars. So whereas this car has this huge overhang in the back in here, this is a small footprint for a big car. This thing would be rated against much smaller vehicles. When you have a vehicle like this, where the wheels are at the ends, this is rated against much larger vehicles, even though it's a small car. Huh.
So that car could be rated against this if, you know,
right.
Theoretically. Huh.
Theoretically, right. So the idea is that for every inch you make this longer, you have to multiply it by the width of the car. But every inch you make it wider, you multiply it by the length of the wheelbase of the car. So we imagine that the tracks on cars are going to get wider. So you're going to have a relatively narrow car, but the wheels way out to the edges, just to get as wide as possible, and the wheels in the corners to get it as long as possible.
Yeah.
So that way the car will get as easy fuel economy regulations, or in this case actually emissions, as possible. So you're going to see this over time. You can already see it now with the new Honda Civics. The wheels are at the ends. All the new cars, especially small cars, are going to get right out to the end so that they can get the easier emissions.
But we can talk about that another time.
Right.
Because we're running
out
of time.
Pretty sneaky.
Okay.
One last thing before we get away from this, talking about regulations and safety and stuff, if you show the picture that Sam has on the computer right now, that truck there is a mobile safety inspection truck. You can go to the next pictures too. There's four pictures there. Now the interesting thing is that's at an RCA plant in New Jersey, I believe. And the car in the front, which is a Rambler, is going up. There's a dynamometer there. So they're measuring something that way. And that the Oldsmobile there on the left, I'm not sure what they are doing, but they do jack it up and you can see somebody checking the front end, I guess just for alignment somehow. And I think there is brake testing further back that you can't see. But the most interesting thing is that's a Boyertown built body on that truck.
Ooh.
So there's a bunch of pictures there. You can go to the next picture there. Just shows the front of it.
Huh.
And again,
fire safety inspection. Is that
free.
What that said?
Free.
Free. Yeah.
Okay.
And the next one. And that's it. It's nothing real exciting, but you could see that the old Boyertown body was involved with that's the state of New Jersey there for
New Jersey for a long time had really good safety inspections where you pull the car into a service bay and it would go through three or four different steps as it would test the brakes, the wheel alignment, the emissions.
I remember going as a kid with my dad, and it was the neatest thing because you're sitting there in a car, and you go through all these things, and they tell you this and this. And I think there was one place where one of the inspection men would get in the car, and maybe that was for the brake test because he would kind of gun it and then hit the brakes, and there's four pads, and they can measure something. But, you know, as a 10-year-old kid, it was great. Then when I got my first car and took it for inspection, then I was scared. I remember failing.
So. Just pass it. Just pass it. Yeah.
Please, so. Please, please.
But that was interesting. It's cool.
Okay. So.
Huh.
Okay.
All right.
Do we feel safer now?
Always.
Always. Okay. Good answer.
Well, thank you both. That was a lot of research. I appreciate that.
Fun stuff, though.
Yeah. Well, it's time for car quiz. I think we can fit in one or two here before we have to move on for the evening. The phone number again here at the studio is 610-378-0426. I do have to say, while that was very interesting, I was hoping for more conspiracy theory.
Oh, well, that's a whole other show.
Oh, okay. Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah.
We'll work on that.
All right, deal.
Gonna be here about like 6 months from now?
No, make it for September, please. That'd be better.
Okay. Because it's 9 months away. Okay.
I hope my mom's watching because we had one of these.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Anyway, that's the first car there, and it's called the Little Carefree Car.
Oh.
That's in quote marks. Did you see that?
And italicized.
Yeah, and I don't know where it came from.
They facelifted it, but they didn't change the wood grain on the side.
Or take a look at a bumper there. We're talking
That's a big bumper.
Big bumpers, yeah.
Yeah, it is.
So, anyway.
That gives away the age.
Yeah. First mass-produced American car with rack and pinion steering. They made those things for 10 years. They had over 3 million of those they built. Not necessarily that station wagon, but they had coupes, though.
They had three-body styles.
Yeah, yeah. So one of the body styles is based on that. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, if you want to count that, there were four.
Okay.
There was a two-door. There was a three-door. There was this wagon.
The three-door was a hatchback.
The two-door and the three-door looked the same.
Okay, but it had a hatch.
The two-door had a trunk.
Yeah.
But the three-door had a hatch.
And in 2004, Forbes magazine said it was one of the 14 worst cars of all times.
But it's carefree.
It's carefree, yeah.
Sure.
What do Forbes know?
Exploding. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Get in an accident, you could care less at that point.
In 2008, Time magazine said it was among the 50 worst cars of all time.
Ouch.
Let's see. What else can I tell you? They came with four cylinders or six cylinders. Okay, we have a home viewer. What are we looking at there?
I'd say it's a Pinot.
Okay.
Maybe 72, 74, somewhere in there.
Okay. What kind of Pinot, though? There's
Ford Pinot.
Yeah, Ford Pinto. With the wood on the side, they had a name for them. Do you know what that is?
That's how I may be being a Woody. I'm not sure.
No, okay. And, okay, what I'm going to say here is, actually, that was a 77 Ford Pinto, so you were a little early with that. What year did you say again, 72?
72. I thought it was around 72, 74. Yeah. They probably came out with them. They were there after a few years. I remember my one brother-in-law, he had a 70, I think it was a 1 or 72 Pinto.
Yeah,
it was a little two-door.
Yeah.
They kind of all look the same.
Like you said, more or less had like a hatchback on the back of it. That had a big glass in the back and the whole thing like lifted up.
Okay. Anyway, that is a Country Squire. When they had the station wagon with the wood on the side, they're called Country Squire. And they used that term for years and years.
You have a very good show tonight, Dan. It's very interesting.
Oh, thanks. Well, it's...
Enjoy it. We always enjoy it every month.
Oh, okay. We do too. Can you tell?
Happy New Year to your family and everybody else on the show.
Yeah. All right. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome, man.
Yep.
Goodbye.
Okay, so anyway, that was a 77 Ford Pinto Country Squire. And as I say, over 3 million of them. And Sam was talking about the different models. They had the cruising wagon.
Cruising wagon was the
which
van.
Was a little panel thing with that round bubble window on the side and the back.
Years ago, I found out that the stripes on the cruising wagon, which I thought were standard, were optional.
Really?
You could get it striped delete, and it just was one color with that bubble window.
Silver, I think, was the color of pigment.
I saw a white one. They were in at least two or three different colors, but you could get it striped delete. And it just looked really sharp.
Okay. Now, we can show the next picture and continue talking about this Pinto, because I think when that Pinto came out, they also came out with the full-size Econoline van that kind of matched it. I remember seeing both of them in advertisements.
Yeah, the cruising van.
Yeah. Remember that back in the mid-70s?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Mercury came out with a Pinto. Kids. What was it called?
The Bobcat.
The Bobcat.
And I have that here, too.
Bobcat,
yeah. Mercury Bobcat.
Who?
Which is like a baby cougar, I guess. Supposedly.
True.
I don't know.
True.
Pinto, Mustang, Bobcat, Cougar. See
what they're doing there.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, we have another car up there. Let's see. What is that? That's a four-door, six-passenger sedan. Also called a saloon from the country that's from. There's a hint. Standard equipment was Borg Warner automatic transmission, variable ratio power steering, built-in walnut tables.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Behind the front seats, come down.
Yep.
That's
Nice.
That's the height of luxury right there.
Top speed was 120 to 125. Back then, that was moving. Well,
that's pretty good.
Still moving. And when that was brand new, cost almost $7,000, which was a hefty sum of money.
They kept this basic style for about 20 years.
Yeah. I had a little matchbox car look like that.
Oh, yeah. It was.
Okay, let's see. What else is it? 265 horsepower motor.
Inline six?
4.2. I believe so. I believe that was in line. I don't have it written here. But, So, I heard the phone ringing here. So, if we have a home viewer, I'm hanging on for another moment here. Got 14 or 15 miles a gallon, which is...
Oh, yes,
hello.
We do.
We have a home viewer. What are we looking at there?
It's a Jaguar Mark 7.
Okay. How about a Mark X?
1975.
How about 1966 Jaguar, Mark X, or maybe it's Mark 10. So, and that Mark 7, I believe, I remember hearing about them. I'm not really sure. It might be a bigger motor.
That was earlier, though. Yeah.
Oh, it was earlier.
It was a bigger car.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
This was the mid-sized car.
So anyway, yeah, that's a Jaguar. You got that part right, but it's a 66.
Okay, it's a six-cylinder.
Yes, yeah. Sir.
Double overhead cam.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So.
Yeah, it was a sharp car for its day.
Yeah. Now, did you have one of them or similar to that?
No, I'm from England and I recognize the car.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I kind of picked up on your accent a little bit, and I was thinking, should I ask you? So, okay. Well, thank you for calling in.
And thank you.
So, nice try.
I was going to say, unfortunately, I know you've got more here. Fortunately,
next month.
We've run out of time, so we'll save those cards for next month. And yep. For our second show in 2017. So, thank you, Dan and Sam, for all your work tonight. Took lots of notes.
Wow.
Yeah. My notes are going here. So, thank you for joining us here at Wheels Along the Road tonight. And be sure to visit us at the Boyertown Museum. And we will see you all in February. Have a good night.
All right.
Wheels Along the Road on BCTV is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.